Could someone really swim down to the wreck of the Titanic? How can three men boil alive in freezing deep-sea temperatures? Let's find out as we follow Mark on what could be a one-way trip to the bottom of the ocean. Mark is renowned for his obsession with the ocean, a love that's been with him since childhood. Even now, he longs to live on the sea and daydreams of what it might be like if he could breathe underwater. All of his life, his closest friends have always teased him about his ocean mania. But this year, for his 30th birthday, they have lovingly planned a diving trip. But not just any diving trip, they were heading out to the Pacific Ocean, east of the Mariana Islands, in order to take him to the Mariana Trench. It is the diving trip of his dreams. Prior to the trip, Mark had spent months preparing, focusing on leg and core workouts. He practiced holding his breath for long periods of time. On the day his friends told him of the trip, he decided he was going to dive as deep as his body would physically allow him to go. He successfully kept this secret from his friends because he knew they would try to talk him out of it. They'd woken up early in the morning and set out on the ocean blue. Mark suits up in his scuba gear while still not telling his friends about his plans. He knows that they'd try to stop him from what his friends call a foolish endeavor. Mark dives into the ocean, immediately swimming down. Now, the human body's accustomed to air pressure, but as you go deeper into the ocean depths, the pressure around you increases from the weight of the water above you. While this might not be exact, it's believed that for around every 10 meters or 33 feet, the pressure increases by one atmosphere. That's around 14.7 pounds per square inch. When it comes to deep-sea diving, pressure is everything. Prepare to hear the word pressure an awful lot over the course of Mark's unfortunate deep-sea adventure. But before we go any further, we have a question for you. Do you sometimes feel like there's a pressure weighing on you? The kind that interferes with your happiness or prevents you from achieving your goals? Regardless if you have a clinical mental health issue like depression or anxiety, or if you're just a human who lives in this world who's going through a hard time, therapy can give you the tools to approach your life in a very different way. And that's why I'm excited to tell you about today's sponsor, BetterHelp. BetterHelp's mission is to make therapy more affordable and more accessible, and this is an important mission because finding a therapist can be really hard, especially when you're limited to the options in your area. BetterHelp is a platform that makes finding a therapist easier because it's online, it's remote, and by filling out a few questions, BetterHelp can match you to a professional therapist in as little as a few days. It's easy to sign up and get matched with a therapist. There's a link in my description. It's betterhelp.com/infographics. Clicking the link helps support this channel, but it also gets you 10% off your first month of BetterHelp, so you can connect with a therapist and see if it helps you. And because finding a therapist is a little like dating, if you don't really fit with that therapist, which is a common thing with therapy, you can easily switch to a new therapist at no additional cost, without stressing about insurance, who's in your network, or anything like that. So if you're struggling, consider online therapy with BetterHelp. Click the link in the description or visit betterhelp.com/infographics. Thank you again, BetterHelp, for supporting this channel. Now back to Mark's dive. A few feet down, Mark quickly notices a change in pressure. The first giveaway is the increased pressure he feels in his eardrums due to the increase in hydrostatic pressure. Mark's body adjusts to the changes as he continues to go further and further down. He quickly leaves his friends far behind him. Mark discovers that, like a lot of people, he's able to safely dive down to 60 feet. His heartbeat has slowed by 25%, and his body begins to move blood to his most vital organs. It prioritizes the organs that'll keep the body functioning as a way to cope with the pressure change. You might have heard of this as peripheral vasoconstriction. It's also common when someone's exposed to cold climates. In those cases, it's to prevent the body from losing heat. It's important to remember that oxygen becomes toxic at greater depths thanks to the higher pressure. Normally, without proper equipment at this depth, people at 184 feet will find that the air has become toxic. But Mark prepared, and he manages to swim past this depth thanks to his equipment. At around 100 feet, Mark's body has to fight against four atmospheres of pressure. The more pressure that's applied, the more gas and oxygen in the body decreases. He continues down until he reaches 436 feet, the world record for freediving. The last time someone had reached this depth was Alexei Molchanov in Villefranche-sur-Mer, France on June 30, 2023. Molchanov had also managed to do it in a single breath, holding his breath for 4 minutes and 42 seconds. When Molchanov was asked about his dive, he said, "My dive felt good, but I'm tired. Overall, I feel strong. I felt clean as well, but it's not my favorite discipline." The record had been previously held by Arnaud Giraud, who had reached 400 feet. Our Mark has decided to forego holding his breath. If he wants to get as low as he can, he's going to have to rely on being able to breathe the entire way down. As Mark continues his descent, his lungs will continue to contract under the pressure of the water. He reaches 700 feet, and his lungs continue to shrink. It makes it more difficult to breathe, but not impossible. Even though our bodies are up to 60% water, they weren't built for the murky depths of the ocean. When it comes to humans and scuba diving, it's more about how much water pressure will crush the air spaces within the human body first, than how much water you have within you. While his friends begin to panic, as he's going much lower than planned, Mark is undeterred. Aware that panic is what kills many divers, Mark keeps his cool. When a diver panics, they're more likely to try to make a beeline back to the surface. While panicking, they'll often be at risk of drowning, lung overexpansion injuries, and decompression sickness. All of these can cause serious injury or death. Two of Mark's friends, Corinne and Steve, try to reach Mark, but both of them panic. Steve turns back after 40 feet. Corinne is only able to follow him down to 60 feet before she quickly turns around and swims back to the surface. This is a big mistake. Poor Corinne and Steve have given themselves the bends. The bends, also known as decompression sickness or generalized barotrauma, occurs when a person experiences a rapid decrease in the pressure around them. It can be air or water pressure, but people are more familiar with it in a scuba diving setting. It's significantly rarer on a pressurized aircraft. When diving with compressed air, divers are breathing in extra oxygen and nitrogen. The nitrogen dissolves in a diver's blood. So if you swim back to the surface too quickly, you don't give your body enough time to clear out the nitrogen in the bloodstream. This leads to the gas forming bubbles in your tissue and blood, causing decompression sickness. Steve's case is far more mild, or type 1. It'll cause pain in his body, especially the joints of his arms and legs. In some cases, it can cause pain in the back and muscles, or the location of the pain can be difficult to pin down. Steve also gets some of the less common symptoms, which are itching, skin mottling, rashes, swelling of the arms, and extreme fatigue. Fortunately, it's not life-threatening, but it does make him miserable. Corinne sadly has type 2, which usually results in neurologic symptoms, and she has gotten the worst of it all, it seems. As Corinne's spinal cord is particularly vulnerable, she suffers from numbness, tingling, and weakness in her arms and legs. Her brain is also impacted as she has a headache, trouble speaking, and double vision, all of which leads to confusion. Loss of consciousness is rare, and in Corinne's case, she remains conscious. Corinne's inner ear is damaged, giving her severe vertigo and ringing in the ears. This can lead to hearing loss, but she doesn't succumb to this particular symptom. Corinne has gas bubbles that have traveled through her veins to her lungs. She's struggling with chest pain, coughing, and it's become progressively more difficult to breathe. In some cases, this can cause shock and death in someone with a bends. If Corinne doesn't receive treatment immediately, all of the damage could become permanent, and she may even die. Rudy, yet another one of Mark's friends, isn't the brightest, but he has a heart of gold. Desperate to help his friend Mark, Rudy dives down and makes it to 300 feet. Not planning ahead, Rudy realizes he has an insufficient amount of gas. There's conflicting information on just how common it is to die from inadequate gas supply. According to an ANZ survey, it's around 56%, while a survey conducted by DAN says it's 41%. Rudy is far from the first person to run out of gas during a dive. Many die due to trying to conserve oxygen for fear of running out before they reach the surface. In Rudy's case, he's not able to make it back to the surface in time, and he drowns. John, Mark's oldest friend, also tries to save his buddy. Sadly, he's a victim of one of the most common causes of death for divers. 90% of divers die with their weight belt on. When John is forced to turn back due to low air supply, he forgets to remove his weight belt. The extra weight makes it too difficult for him to swim to the surface, drowning before anyone can get to him. Mark's friends might have fared better if they had read Diving Medicine for Scuba Divers by Dr. Carl Edmonds, Dr. Bart McKenzie, Dr. Robert Thomas, and John Pennefather. In a chapter titled Why Divers Die, they discuss that diving fatality data reveals 80% of divers were alone when they died. They recommend a buddy system, which Mark's friends did not implement. If you have a buddy with you, they can assist you when things go wrong. Mark is also aware that when a human is crushed underwater, it's often due to a sudden change in pressure. Knowing this, he's given his body a chance to adjust the entire way down. He's also opted out of wearing a pressure suit. Since the water is able to touch his body, all Mark has to focus on is equalizing his air spaces. If he can continue to equalize his air spaces, like his lungs, with gas, he can prevent being crushed. There are some devastating examples of a sudden change in pressure underwater, though. On November 5, 1983, at 4 in the morning, five men lost their lives in the Byford Dolphin accident when a compression mechanism malfunctioned. The Byford Dolphin was a semi-submersible drilling rig that was at the time stationed in the Frigg gas field, a natural gas field in the Norwegian sector of the North Sea. William Crammond was in the middle of a routine procedure when he connected the diving bell to the living chambers of the rig that held two divers each. Normally, the diving bell wouldn't be detached from the living chambers until the chamber doors were shut. Sadly, the diving bell detached before they could finish closing, leading to an explosive decompression. The air pressure went from 9 atmospheres to 1 atmosphere. In the rush of air from the chamber, Crammond was killed by the diving bell flying out. It also critically injured his co-worker, Martin Saunders. The divers who were in the living chambers met a horrific fate. It's said that three of the men, Edwin Arthur Coward, Roy P. Lucas, and Bjorn Javer Bergesen, were boiled alive from the inside out. The nitrogen in their blood transformed into gas bubbles, killing them instantly. The fourth diver, Troels Hellevik, was in front of the partially opened door when the diving bell detached, and he was sucked out. But the opening was so narrow that it tore him open and scattered his internal organs into the deck of the ship. Mark reaches a depth once thought impossible, 12,500 feet. The Titanic also lies at 12,500 feet below sea level. This would make the pressure 380 atmosphere. You could compare that to having an elephant standing on every inch of your body. In a lot of cases, most people's lungs collapse before they even reach 1,000 feet. However, in 1992, a French diving company called Comex conducted several experimental dives. Thanks to saturation diving, they were able to send a diver down to 2,300 feet, or 701 meters, for 2 hours. This diver was under 71.1 atmospheres of pressure at this depth. Before we return to Mark and his soon-to-be watery grave, let's talk about just what exactly saturation diving is. It's actually what most people think of when they think of deep diving, even if they're not aware of it. The diver, someone like Mark, will breathe in inert gas that'll dissolve into the body's tissues. It will reach equilibrium with the water pressure at the diver's depth. But once the tissue is fully saturated, it cannot absorb any more. This will allow divers to stay underwater for days or even a week or more. Our friend Mark could theoretically stay under for weeks if he played his cards right, but we're not totally sure he's really prepared for this. Most of the time, saturation diving only goes between 65 feet and 1,000 feet. It doesn't go nearly as deep down as Mark wishes. Actually, he might be able to learn a thing or two from real-life saturation diver Shannon Hovey. He and five other men spent 52 days during the winter of 2018 inside of a ship in the Gulf of Mexico. Hovey is just one of the saturation divers that do construction and demolition work underwater. Sometimes divers go as deep as 1,000 feet or more to do their job. Hovey knows it's safe to have the gas inside of his body while diving as long as the weight of the water above him will keep it compressed. When he has to return to the surface, he'll have to wait for it to diffuse slowly. During that 6-week assignment, Hovey and his fellow divers remained at the somewhat shallow depth of 250 feet. That's pretty deep, though. They made sure that their ship capsule was pressured to the same level. Right before the job begins, Hovey will call his family to have one more conversation with him. He could speak with them from the ship, but he knows that if he does, he'll sound like Donald Duck sucking in a helium balloon. Hovey is just one example that Mark could look to in order to make his dive safer, but we know he never will. Funny enough, scientists look to a piece of fiction when discussing the future of deep diving. In the 1989 film The Abyss, the characters are able to use a fictional breathing system to plunge the ocean depths. They use oxygenated fluid for breathing, which involves a substance known as perfluorocarbon, or PFC. PFC is an actual compound that can dissolve high amounts of gases like oxygen. If we were to fill Mark's lungs with an oxygen-rich fluid, similar to PFC, it might allow him to withstand the intense pressures of the deep sea without his lungs collapsing. So why not just do this now? Couldn't it revolutionize deep sea diving? It's easier said than done. There are a lot of complications that come with a liquid like PFC. You'd have to be able to remove the carbon dioxide from the liquid, which is what humans breathe out. It's a lot trickier to remove carbon dioxide from the liquid than it is to remove it in gas. Without the ability to get rid of it, Mark would struggle with CO2 buildup that would most likely kill him. Another reality is that the human lungs are just not built to breathe in liquid. Trying to fill Mark's lungs with something like PFC would require so much effort, it would absolutely exhaust him. So it's great for science fiction, but reality isn't quite compatible with it, at least not yet. Perhaps someday scientists will be able to figure out something that'll allow humans to deep dive without a machine. Science fiction aside, there are some very real efforts to improve the technology of diving. There are plenty of innovations for diving suits, breathing apparatuses, mixed gas technology, and decompression techniques. While the future of deep sea diving looks bright, none of this will help Mark in the here and now. So, what if Mark's lungs didn't collapse? How deep would he have to go until his body was completely crushed? Fortunately for Mark, human bones crush at around 24,600 pounds per square inch. He would have to dive 22 miles down before the ocean had enough strength to crush the bones in his body. The Mariana Trench is the deepest part of the ocean, and it reaches 11,034 meters, which is 36,200 feet, or 7 miles. It's more likely that Mark would drown or die from too much pressure on his lungs than being crushed completely. In order for his entire body to be crushed, he would need to be able to go 3 times deeper than the Mariana Trench. So, how deep can Mark actually go? Admittedly, research on this is spotty, and no one's entirely sure exactly what depth the pressure of the ocean will crush your lungs, especially since everyone's different. Our Mark manages to keep his lungs from being crushed most of the way down and makes his way to the bottom of the Mariana Trench. This is where we'll likely see Mark meet his end. While it might not have been enough to crush his body, it is enough to cause his lungs to collapse. At the bottom of the Mariana Trench, Mark not only faces extreme water pressure, but he also faces temperatures of below 0 degrees Celsius, darkness, and all the strange wildlife it has to offer. Betrayed by his first love, the sea itself, Mark's body succumbs to the pressure and floats to the bottom of the Mariana Trench for the fish to feast upon. Although he has never been granted the ability to breathe underwater, he's now free to become one with his true love, the ocean. Don't you just love a happy ending? If you like this video, check out what happens to your body at the bottom of the ocean, or watch this video instead.